thanks so much for staying with Morning Live. And as promised earlier, today marks the 56th anniversary of the arrest of anti-apartheid activists at Liliesleaf farm in Rivonia, north of Johannesburg. In 1963, Nelson Mandela, Ahmed Kathrada, Denis Goldberg and Mlangeni were accused of treason and stood trial. SABC caught up with struggle giant Denis Goldberg, and this is how it went.
Liliesleaf farm was actually bought by the Communist Party as a place for secret meetings, and our comrade Ahmed Kathrada, Kathy, was the janitor, so to speak. But more and more people kept going there, and eventually Nelson Mandela arrived there when he returned from his trip abroad through Africa and came back. Had travelled South Africa to tell various people about his discussions of the possibility of armed struggle and the necessity for it. He played the role of a houseboy dressed in a blue overall and used to serve tea to the farm workers. They'd say, "Here, boy, come give us tea." But he also used to sell the vegetables grown on the farm at the local police station. That was the disguise. Arthur Goldreich and his wife Hazel and their two children lived there as though this, what was then a very luxurious house for the time, pretty ordinary today, but then it was something very special. And I have to say that we were living there. I eventually ended up there as well, and they were always nervous that so many people had come. It was dangerous. The police might raid at any time. And in fact, we'd bought a new place in Trevallon, agricultural holdings, as a headquarters. And Walter Sisulu and Raymond Mshlaba, Governor Mbeki, and me had moved there with Wilton and Quire. And so we came to what was to be one last meeting at Liliesleaf. And the reason for one last meeting was it was known to too many people. In other words, we had taken the decision never to go there again. Only Rusty Bernstein was under house arrest. He had to report to the police, and even on a Saturday had to be home by 1 o'clock after reporting to the police. And the high command, with the representatives of the various Congress organizations, had met on a Saturday, and they couldn't agree where to meet and agreed on one more meeting. And that's the day that we were raided. The story told by the police, and I'm inclined to agree with it, was that Bruno Mtolo, Mr. X, an activist in Umkhonto, an expert explosives man from Durban and what's now KwaZulu-Natal, was arrested, found, and he was an old, ordinary criminal. And ordinary criminals, when they're caught, give information in exchange for their freedom. And he told them there was a place called Ivon, didn't know where it was, but they drove around Johannesburg until they found it. In fact, the Ivon was a sign called Rivonia, which had been bent backwards and just I-V-O-N showed. And so they raided us. Liliesleaf, it was very nice. The goose used to wander around there. I used to fight them off with a stick when I got out of the car. But when the security police came, they just lay down. You know, they weren't...
Why was the decision taken for Liliesleaf itself? Do you know? Was there any thinking behind why that specific...
Why? Because Liliesleaf was next to Sleepy Hollow nightclub. There was nothing there. It was literally in the deep countryside in those days. So no traffic came there. There weren't casual passers-by. What we subsequently discovered was that there was a caravan park, which we knew about, and that there was what we believe was a British agent who used to climb a ladder every day to have a look at what was happening all round. And he was reporting on what happened. Now, what we know is that when inquiries were made many years later, He had been instructed not to give any information to South African intelligence or police. They wanted their own intelligence. They were all watching the ANC, the British, the Americans, the Germans. Anything to do with the ANC for them was suspect. And so they were watching us and had caught up with us in a way that the South African security arrangements hadn't.
Doctor, so this fateful meeting, if one can call it that, well, it was really the last meeting that was to be held at Liliesleaf. Talk to us a bit about that day. What do you remember from the start of the day till to the actual raid?
Well, we, that means Raymond Mhlaba and Governor Mbeki and Walter Sisulu were going from Krugersdorp to Vallon Holdings to the meeting. I think it was going to start at 12 o'clock, that sort of time in the morning. And we drove there. And I must admit, I was usually on the watch. We didn't drive past the police station. Or maybe we did, and we talked afterwards, we'd seen an old van there. But it didn't raise any alarms. Rusty Bernstein saw it. It was an old van with a laundry delivery van. And apparently that was the security police. And they delayed their raid because they decided at the last minute they needed a search warrant. And so it was all delayed for a couple of hours. We just happened to be there, middle of winter, 11th of July. And I tell you, when the police raided, I was sitting in the lounge of the house and the great big double doors to the terrace opened and big fat Sergeant Durka, the security police, came dancing in with his hat on and his great big raincoat and his hands stuffed in his pockets, obviously holding a revolver of some kind. And I was there, sitting, trying to keep warm, reading a book. It was called Brighter Than a Thousand Suns, the story of the nuclear bomb dropped on Hiroshima a few years earlier in Japan towards the end of World War II. And there he was, and I grabbed my notebook with notes about what I'd been doing and ran for the toilet to get rid of the notes about where we were going to buy the ingredients for explosives, the boxes for the landmines, where we're going to buy the hand grenade casings and so on. But the police were waiting for me and they took my book off. And I tell you, it got very, very cold.